Okay, happy Easter to everyone. As I text John and my brother and some other people today, he is risen. Sure as I stand here, he's risen. All right, you recall from last week that after killing an Egyptian, you remember Moses, he fled to Midian, and then 40 years later, when Moses is 80 years old, God then calls him to return to Egypt to be his representative in freeing the Israelites from Egyptian bondage. Now, when Moses and his brother Aaron, they first confronted Pharaoh with the command that Yahweh, the God of the Hebrews, the true and living God, that he commands Pharaoh to allow the Hebrews to go out and worship him in the wilderness. Well, Pharaoh at that time, he increased the people's workload, and the people weren't happy with that. So they were upset with Moses and Aaron for having made their situation worse. And when Moses complained to God, God said to Moses, in essence, you just keep watching. Okay, you just keep watching. And by the Lord's instruction, Moses goes back and he tells the people, listen, he says, God is going to bring you out of Egyptian bondage. They're upset, they're distressed, they're complaining. He goes back and tells them that, but the people wouldn't listen. The text says, because of their broken spirit and harsh slavery. So Moses is telling them that, but they're just not really hearing it because their situation is so difficult. In chapter 7, God gives a preview of how this is going to play out. And then he sends Moses and Aaron, he sends them back to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh says to them, he says, look, I want you to prove yourselves by working a miracle. I mean, who are you? You come bopping into my presence, you know, show me something. You're telling me God, Yahweh, wants me to let you go. Show me something. So in keeping with the Lord's instruction, Aaron threw down his staff and it became a snake. Well, that's pretty impressive. But of course, Pharaoh's magicians did the same thing. It says by their secret arts. A number of magicians throw down their staffs and do the same thing by their secret arts. But Aaron's snake then goes and eats every one of those snakes. So you have multiple snakes there. One Aaron throws down. The magicians throw staffs down, become snakes. And then his eats all of them. And I think that's a pretty powerful witness. Now, we're not told how the magicians duplicated the miracle performed by God. If their staffs actually did become snakes, as Aaron's had done, if that actually occurred, instead of only appearing to do that through trickery or magical deception, well, if that was the case, it must be through some satanic power that God was allowing to be exercised. So we're just not told. It simply says they did it by their secret arts. Okay, so we're not, no, but it's one of those two, it seems to me. Now, the fact that Aaron's snake swallowed all the other snakes, that shows, that leaves no doubt where the real power lies. That the real power is with God. And interestingly, snakes represented Egyptian power. You know, the pictures like the headdresses with the snakes up on them. And so here, that comes into play here. But Pharaoh, he remains unmoved. And in Exodus 7:13, it says, still Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he would not listen to them as the Lord had said. Now we get to the 10 plagues. The 10 plagues that I know most of you have heard since you were children. But the account of the 10 plagues runs from chapter 7, verse 14, down through chapter 12, verse 32. And the overview of the plagues is that God commands Pharaoh repeatedly through Moses and Aaron to let his people go so that they might worship him in the wilderness. But Pharaoh refuses to do so until the final plague comes and is visited on the people of Egypt, and then he lets them go as God had said he would. But that's the overview of it. God first, the first plague, he turns the Nile and various inland bodies of water, he turns them into blood. And when you think about that, that's pretty serious. The fish died, the river stank, blood is everywhere. And in Exodus 7:22, it says the magicians did the same by their magic arts. Now, since the Nile was already blood and the inland waters were already blood, it must mean that they turned or they appeared to turn, whichever was the case, whether it was through satanic power granted by God or through some kind of magical trickery or deception, it must mean that they turned or appeared to turn some small quantity of water. Everything else is blood. So they turned some small quantity of water, perhaps some of what the people were digging for along the Nile. Remember that God allowed that they dug along the Nile and they could get water. So they turned some small quantity of water into blood, and it's significant they didn't change the Nile back into water. They couldn't counteract what had been done, but they had something that they could do, and they come show Pharaoh and say, "Now you see, look at this." And so that was enough. See, given the hardness of Pharaoh's heart or his inclinations, it was enough for him to convince himself that he didn't need to yield. And that's how they're functioning. You say they're giving him an excuse to rationalize. No, 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 that looks pretty good. But look, it's not all that different. You see, the powers that are available to you, you see, you have powers available to you. So this isn't something about anything you need to submit to. So he's willing to run with that despite whatever differences there were. In the second plague, you see in chapter 8, verses 1 to 15, God brings countless frogs upon the land. Now, these things, early, they're more of a nuisance, you know, just a bummer. But he brings countless frogs onto the land, and again, the magicians do something similar. But again, it's obviously of lesser scope because there were already frogs everywhere. But somehow they are able to duplicate that miracle to some way, in some way or to some extent. But Pharaoh tells Moses and Aaron, he says, look, plead with Yahweh to remove the frogs, and he says he will let the Hebrews go. I mean, I'm looking around, frogs everywhere. He says, look, you plead with Yahweh to remove the frogs, and I'll let the people go and sacrifice. Well, the next day, the Lord does that. He causes the frogs to leave in response to Moses' prayer, but when Pharaoh sees, well, the frogs are gone. He reneges. Okay, he changes his mind and he won't let the people go, though he had said, do this and I will let them go. He won't let them do it. In the third plague, chapter 8, verse 16 to 19, you have gnats or possibly mosquitoes. Gnats or mosquitoes, they covered the place. Just being all over the people, all over the animals, and the magicians ran out of tricks at that point. See, so whatever is going on, where they can do the snake thing and that kind of, they do the thing with the frogs, they do the thing water to blood. This is it for them. So either God is shutting them off right now or their trickery won't go that far and they're not able to do that. And even the magicians say to Pharaoh, they say, this is the finger of God. His own magicians come to him and say, this is the finger of God. Look, I'm telling you. You know, we know this stuff. This is our world. And I'm telling you, this is not something, the kind of thing we do. This is the finger of God, but Pharaoh's heart was hardened. In the fourth plague, in chapter 8, verse 20 to 32, you have great swarms of flies coming on all the people. They're in their houses. They're all over the land. But Goshen, the place where the Hebrews dwell, is specifically exempted. It is a true no-fly zone. Okay? We've got no flies there. Now, that may suggest, by the way, that that's true of all the miracles. You see, is that always that Goshen is exempted, the place where Israel lives. But you only get this specifically stated in certain places. Here is a place where it's specifically stated. And Pharaoh says he'll let the Hebrews sacrifice to Yahweh in the wilderness. And he asked Moses to plead for him, which means that he wants him to plead for the removal of the flies. God grants Moses' prayer, removes the flies, but Pharaoh again hardened his heart and reneged. This is getting to be like Lucy with the football. You know, he said, no, do this, I'll do it. No, he does it, and then he says, no, not going to do it. So this happens again. Now, in the fifth plague, in chapter 9, verses 1 to 7, a death-producing disease comes on all the various kinds of livestock of the Egyptians, horses, donkeys, camels, sheep, goats, and their populations were decimated, but not one of the livestock of the Israelites died. Not one of the livestock of the people of Israel died, but Pharaoh's heart was hardened and he refused to relent. He's not going to say uncle. He's in a battle with Yahweh. He's the representative of Horus and of the gods of Egypt, and he says, listen, we're not yielding. You haven't broken me. I'm not going to do this. I am the ruler of the great people of Egypt. And so he will not relent. In the sixth plague, boil in chapter 9, verse 8 to 12, boils came on the Egyptians and their beasts. Now this is getting, you see, it's intensifying, right? It's getting worse. Going from a nuisance, annoyance, now I got boils on me. These painful boils. And the magicians, it says, they couldn't stand before Moses because of the boils. These are some serious boils. They can't even come and stand. So that's very significant, right? These magicians who are, they're representing Pharaoh's access to these powers. And now the thing's got to the point that they can't come and stand before Moses. They can't even do that. So this happens, they can't stand before him. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. Now this is the first time it mentions God as hardening. And this is part of the punishment of Pharaoh in his recalcitrance, in his rebellion. God is going to use him and confirm him in his rebellion. And he's going to harden him so that his majesty might be displayed more and more. But he wouldn't listen to, so the Lord hardens his heart and Pharaoh would not listen, it says, to them, presumably meaning the magicians and the Egyptians who are suffering from the boils. And they're coming to Pharaoh and saying, "You're killing me. You are killing me with this. Will you stop?" But no, he won't listen to them, you see. The seventh plague, chapter 9, 13 to 35, God brings an unprecedented hailstorm that pummeled the crops. And it killed all the people and animals that remained outside despite the Lord's warning. You see, everybody that believed what the Lord had said, they all came inside. Brought their animals inside, but those who didn't believe what the Lord said left them outside. Well, that was a bad move. You see, not believing what God has said, so they pummeled the crops. It killed all the people and the animals who were outside, but Goshen, where the people of Israel lived, was a hail-free zone. So all over you've got hail, tremendous hail, unprecedented hail, just smoke and everything. It's like bombing. And over here in Goshen, what? Hey, well, you know, sunny. No hail here. You see what God is doing and what God is letting Pharaoh and the world see. And Pharaoh tells Moses and Aaron, he says, "This time I've sinned. Yahweh's in the right and I and my people are in the wrong." And he asks him to plead for the hail to cease and he'll let them go. And Moses says he'll do it, but he tells Pharaoh, "I know that you do not yet fear Yahweh our God. I'm going to do it, but let me tell you something. I know that you do not yet fear. You're going to, but I know that you're not quite there yet." So he said, when the Lord relented and ceased the hailstorm, Pharaoh again hardened his heart and he reneged. The eighth plague, chapter 10, verses 1 to 20, Moses and Aaron tell Pharaoh he's going to be overrun with locusts. That's what's next on the agenda. You're going to be overrun with locusts who will blanket the place. They'll devour whatever crops are left, and they're going to eat the trees. Now, you know, in a place like this, I mean, do you understand how horrible that is? But he tells him that's what's going to happen. And Pharaoh's servants, they try to talk sense into him. They try to say, "Will you please stop this?" You know, and this is part, I think there was an article, I don't remember who wrote it, but it was in the Tyndale Bulletin some years ago, a fellow who was making the argument that, see, part of God's power over the representative God, Pharaoh, is that he controls him to the extent that he does things that no sane person would do, that God might show his power, but that's part of his power over this God. That I can control you so that you will slit your own throat and commit suicide. But in any event, he doesn't. Pharaoh won't do what he's saying. And we have you have these locusts coming everywhere. The people are urging him, "Listen, will you go ahead and not do this?" But Pharaoh refuses to let the Israelites go on their own terms. This is when he tries to say, "Well, look, you can do this or that." And they say, "No, that's not going to work." So he refuses to let them go on their own terms. So God brings this devastating locust attack. And Pharaoh then says, "I've sinned against Yahweh your God and against you." And he begs them to plead with Yahweh to remove the plague. But the text says this time that the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart and he did not let the people go. So here we have again, this is just ratcheting up. God is demonstrating his power over Pharaoh. The ninth plague, chapter 10, 21 to 29, you get this absolute and surreal darkness. There was a time Meg and I were in vacationing. I hardly ever take vacations. This was many years ago. We were in Canada, and we were at a hotel, and all the electricity everywhere went out. And I tell you what, I opened the door to this room, into this hallway, and it was like you couldn't tell you were anywhere. You couldn't tell. This was pitch black. And so this is this kind of, there's something about this darkness that God brings on the land for 3 days. But where's the light? There's light where the Israelites live. Dark everywhere. Complete darkness. Can't see anything. By the way, there's light over here. You see, God is showing that there's a difference between his people and his people's enemies. Pharaoh calls Moses in. He said, look, that you can go, but you got to leave your livestock behind. And Moses explains why that's not going to work. That's unacceptable. But the Lord hardens Pharaoh's heart. He will not let the people go. And Pharaoh then tells Moses that the next time you see me, I've about had it with you. Next time we meet, I'm going to kill you. Okay, so Moses then, he announces to Pharaoh, he says, okay, well, here's the 10th plague that's coming. Okay, here's what's going to happen. And you see, the 10th plague gets the most play. It's the most severe. Chapter 11, verse 1 through chapter 12, verse 32. Moses tells Pharaoh, look, in the middle of the night, every firstborn of the land of Egypt is going to die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh to the firstborn of the slave girl to the firstborn of the cattle, there's going to be an unprecedented wailing and mourning and crying and weeping in Egypt. When you see every household with a dead person in it, this is what's going to come on you. This is what's in store. There's going to be that wailing, but the people of Israel will remain untouched. You see, and this is that you, Pharaoh, may know that God makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel. So all the people of Egypt, cattle, slave people, you, firstborn going to be killed. Nobody killed among the people of the, and when that happens, you, Pharaoh, will let the people go. So this is it. And then Moses storms out, hot with anger because of what's going on in this recalcitrance. But pursuant to God's directive, this is before God executes this plague. He says this is going to happen in the middle of the night. But then pursuant to God's directive, in preparation for this, Moses instructs the people of Israel to kill a lamb without blemish. Kill this blemishless lamb, one for each household. And he says, you are to spread the blood from that lamb on the lintel and the doorposts of each house. And you are to stay inside. You put that blood on the lintel and the doorpost, and then all of you stay inside. Inside that house that has that blood on the doorposts and on the lintel. You do that, stay in there, and remain there until morning. Then Exodus chapter 12, verse 23, this works. Well, I'll just read it. Exodus 12, verse 23, it says, for the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood on the lintel and the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your houses to strike you. So we have this blood here, and he says, this is what's going to happen. He's going to come in and smoke this place. But when he sees that blood on the doorpost, the destroyer will not enter and touch anybody in there. So this is very significant. Now, the people were further instructed to roast the lamb and to eat it with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs. And they're to eat it in haste with their belts fastened, their sandals on, and their staffs in their hand. What they're to do it, see, with their staffs in their hand. All of this symbolizes the swift exit from Egypt that God's about to bring about. You see, belts on, feet, sandals on, staff in my hand, eat it in haste. Why? Because it's part of the symbolism that God is, he's letting you out of Egypt. So this is part of that's how they're to do that. And so the people, now in the middle of the night, the Lord did indeed strike down all the firstborn of Egypt. And amidst the great mourning, Pharaoh summons Moses and Aaron to them in the night. And he says in 12:31-32, up, go out from among my people, both you and the people of Israel, and go serve the Lord as you have said. Take your flocks and your herds, if you have said, and be gone. And bless me also. All right, so finally we get Pharaoh saying, all right. When he said, who's this Yahweh? Yahweh? I don't know anything about him. What are you talking, coming to me in the name of Yahweh? All right, well, he knows who Yahweh is now. You see, he knows what it means to defy Yahweh. And so he says, okay, I get it. I give. Go. Please go. I cannot match or engage with your God because he is so powerful. And so off he lets them go. And the people, by the way, this meal that they ate, by the way, when they leave, you see, in very short order, 600,000 men roughly, and besides women and children, marched out of Egypt, and they take with them the silver, the gold, and the jewelry that the people of Egypt had given them. So now that's pretty good, right? Not only have you been slaves, but when God says, I'm going to release you, he releases you, and the people give them all this stuff, all of this wealth. He says, so I'm going to have them give you wealth while you go out. And see, that's something that God does. And Moses carried with him the bones of Joseph, as the sons of Israel had promised. You remember Joseph saying, I know, time's coming, you're going to do that. He says, okay, we got you. You're coming with us. Now, the people were instructed to eat this meal, by the way, each year on the 14th day of the first month as a memorial, as a way of symbolically reliving this great deliverance that God had given them. A way of reconnecting with, keeping fresh in the community as you go down generations and generations and you tell people that just, so this is this annual meal that you're to eat to keep alive among the community as it goes down in time, this great deliverance that God has brought. And this is, of course, the feast known as Passover, because the Lord passed over the houses of Israel in Egypt. Those that had the blood on them, he passed over them and killed the firstborn in all the other places. And it was eaten every year thereafter. To commemorate this great act, God's great act of sparing his people from death. You see, they didn't die. They had the blood. They were inside. They didn't die. So it's God's great act of sparing them from death and taking them from bondage to blessing through the sacrifice of a blemishless lamb. So their life was preserved. They did not die. And they were taken from bondage to blessing. And the instrumentality of that great deliverance was the sacrifice of this blemishless lamb whose blood was put on their doorposts. So this is what the Passover is about. This is what the Passover recalls. And as Terry will no doubt mention today, the Last Supper that Jesus ate with his disciples was a Passover meal. It was a Passover meal. You can see that, for example, in Matthew chapter 26, verses 17 to 19. It was a Passover meal, and we read in Matthew 26, if this clicker works, it says, now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, this is a Passover meal, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took a cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. So here we have Jesus. He institutes a new symbolic meal. He institutes a new symbolic meal by transcending the original meaning of the Passover meal. So he's sharing in this annual Passover meal, but the Lord Jesus takes this meal and he transforms it into a new symbolic meal. He transformed this 1,500-year-old rite. He takes it and transforms it, and he does so in light of his rescuing work. He transcends the original meaning, transforms it In light of his rescuing work, the bread of this new meal, he says, represents his body. And the juice of this new meal represents his blood. And as Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, Jesus is the Passover lamb. He says Jesus is the Passover lamb. He's the innocent one who was sacrificed that God's people might be spared from death and taken from the bondage of an alien power and brought into the glory of the kingdom of God. So yes, God delivered the people of Israel from this alien power of the Egyptians using this blemishless lamb to protect them from death and deliver them. Well, Christ now says, I am the one. You see, who is protecting you from death. And it is through me that you are delivered from the alien power of sin that grips. And you're brought into the kingdom of God. And with the Lord's transformation of this Passover into the Lord's Supper, we as Christians, we don't hark back to the lesser. You see, we don't hark back to the lesser. We celebrate, you know, the Lord's Supper. We don't hark back and celebrate the Passover because that's the type. We celebrate the fulfillment. What transcends that? And we celebrate that weekly in the Lord's Supper. This ultimate deliverance of Christ, which is symbolized in the Lord's Supper. All right, with regard to the 10th and final plague, the Lord said to Moses in Exodus chapter 12, verse 12, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and on all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. So you see here what is going on here. Enforcing Israel's deliverance through this final plague that God brings, that he demonstrated to the Egyptians, he demonstrated to the Israelites, he demonstrated to the whole world his supremacy over Pharaoh, and thus his supremacy over all the so-called gods worshipped by the Egyptians. He exposed them as paper tigers that could not stand before him. Oh, we're doing all these things, these gods, all these things, a multitude of gods working. We've got Horus here on the throne and all that. He says, they're nothing. You see, so this is judgment on all these so-called gods that are worshipped in Egypt. He revealed, you see, that they're nothing and they cannot stand before the true God, the creator of heaven and earth, Yahweh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Cannot stand before him. Then we get to the crossing of the Red Sea. Terry talked about this. I'm looking at the clock back here. I'm trying to go. So we get to the Red Sea. God's not finished with demonstrating his supremacy over Pharaoh and the gods of Egypt. He instructs Moses to have the people, look, change course. So the people change course and to camp in what seemed like a vulnerable position up against the sea. You see, you're trapped now. So he says, they're out here. Why? He says, no, back them up. Take them, go back this way and put them right here. And so when Pharaoh sees this, Pharaoh apparently has people watching this. Word comes to Pharaoh when he sees this. He's saying, look, there. I guess I didn't turn my phone down. Huh. Oh, that was mean. But he sees them going around. And then he says, look, they're wandering. Now they're pinned up against the sea. So that, with this remorse that he had about letting them go in the first place, that prompts him to pursue them. And ancient Israel's deliverance, their deliverance from Egyptian bondage, it was finalized by this passing through a parted Red Sea. You see, and that passage through that parted Red Sea, it began with their going under God's guiding cloud as it moved from their front to their rear to come between them and the Egyptian army. So we have this cloud that passes over them going from the front to the rear. It begins that way. You see that in Exodus 14, 19, and 20. And then Paul, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 and 2, he characterizes this water passage of deliverance as a baptism into Moses. And he then analogizes that to Christian baptism on his way to making the point in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 to 5, that their baptism, the Corinthian Christians' baptism, and their participation in the Lord's Supper will not save them if they continue eating meals at the idol temples. He's been telling them along, you cannot engage in this. You cannot go and participate in the idol feasts in the temples. Are you trying to arouse the Lord's jealousy? So he tells them here in 1 Corinthians 10, 1 to 5, he says this, that this is a type, like this was a baptism into Moses, and that's a type or a kind or analogous to the baptism you had. And he says this as he explains to them, listen, your sharing in baptism and your sharing in participating in the Lord's Supper, that will not save you. Just like their sharing in a kind or type of baptism and their sharing in a kind or type of Lord's Supper did not make them immune or invulnerable, didn't make them immune to disqualification, because he says most of them died in the desert. You see, and we're going to get to that part. Probably not today. Okay? But he says, so that Paul uses this in making that case there. Now, of course, the Egyptian army, the chariots, all, including the chariots, they pursued the Israelites into this parted sea. You know, I could see that being a little dicey, but in they go. And the God throws them into confusion, clogging their wheels. And then when Moses stretches out his hand over the sea, close the channel. Drowns the Egyptians. You see, so this is kind of, this is this final act of deliverance that Paul says is a baptism into Moses. Okay, the journey to Mount Sinai. We come through there, now we're on the way to Mount Sinai. God led the Israelites from the Red Sea to Mount Sinai, which probably is in the southern part of the Sinai Peninsula. That's probably where Mount Sinai is. You can see different marks there for people who think it's a different spot. Okay, we don't know exactly for sure where it is. But it's probably there, and God has them stop at various places on the way, and you can see a more detailed accounting of their journey in Numbers chapter 33, where he says, stopped here, camped here, camped here, camped here. But he leads them down here, he's taking them to Sinai, and after going 3 days into the wilderness of Shur without finding any water, they finally come to some water at Marah, but it's undrinkable. They come, oh, there's water, but no, we can't drink it. It's either salt, bitter, there's something wrong with it. You can't drink it. So naturally, the people are chapped. They cry out against Moses. They're angry, grumble against him. And in response to Moses' prayer, God directs Moses to a log. That's just interesting to me how God often works through these intermediate means. But he directs him to a log, and he purifies the water when Moses throws the log in the water. So you see God working miracles among the people during this whole journey. He's going to be blessing them that way. God led them into the wilderness of Sin. And on the 15th day of the second month after they'd left Egypt, they grumbled against Moses and Aaron because they didn't have sufficient food, they thought. So here they are coming out of this horrible slavery. This is so human. This is so, you know, I see myself sitting here, you see, and they're just grumbling and griping, and they don't remember that. You know how it was when you were back in Egypt? You wouldn't send a dog back there. And now here you are as a free people being made into a nation and listen to you. But I see myself in that. Too much. And so here they're out in the wilderness. They grumbled against Moses. And this is when the Lord began providing manna. Manna from heaven. You see a white, thin, sweet seed or wafer-like substance that was visible each morning when the dew lifted in the morning, except on the seventh day. So God is providing them this food. And you recall Jesus' words in John chapter 6, verse 49 to 51. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This, Jesus, he says, is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. And if anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. I remember having an atheist buddy of mine, old roommate, I had him read John, and his thing was as many years ago, and he did tell me, he said, you know, I don't think anybody talks that way. Indeed. Yeah, nobody does talk that way. That's part of how you, that's a clue that something's up. You see, something's up. But here you have that we have there that Jesus says this, and so he tells him that. Now, God also, now this is presumably here for one night. He provides an abundance of quail for them in the evening. You just have the one verse there about that. But here they're complaining, so they start getting this manna, and that will continue with them. Then at Rephidim, the people again grumble against God because they didn't have against Moses because they didn't have any water. And at God's direction, Moses takes a staff, he smacks this rock, and water pours out. God's miraculous provision for his people. Strikes it, out comes water. Exodus 17, verses 8 to 16. Amalek, he attacks the Israelites at Rephidim, and the Lord gave Israel the victory. And this is significant. God tells Moses, I want you to record this, and I want you to say this in the presence recite this before Joshua, that he, God, will blot out from memory Amalek. And this comes up, by the way. You'll see this happen. You'll see this happen with Saul, and then you'll see this happen again in Esther. You know, when he says here he's Amalekite. You see, this tension and this hostility that Amalek showed to the people of Israel is not forgotten. And so this will pop up, and we can maybe have a chance to say something about that later. Now, Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, he comes to Moses here. This is when Moses is reunited with his wife, Zipporah, and their two kids, Gershom and Eleazar. Apparently, Moses had sent her back at some point, whether it was when he was dealing with Pharaoh or not, we're not told. But this is also when Jethro advises Moses to create a kind of lower court system. He says, there's just too much going on for you to handle. Nobody can handle this kind of... So create a lower court system, essentially, so you've got other people deciding these things, and only the really tough cases will percolate up to you. And then that way it'll decrease your workload. So you remember that. That happens. Now, when we get to Sinai... Oh, I look at the clock. Oh, we get to Sinai, and this is in Exodus chapter 19. They make it there, and there's this awesome manifestation of God's presence, this thunder, lightning, a thick cloud, trumpet blasts, fire, smoke. This is God's presence being symbolized, manifested there. And God calls Moses to the top of the mountain, and he sends him back down to warn the people again who are at the base of the mountain. He says, you make sure that they don't even think about coming up here. Because I am holy God. And if they come up here, they will die. So you make sure that you tell them, you see, that they don't think about venturing up this mountain. And then God thunders out in the hearing of all the people, what are the 10 words, what we call the 10 commandments. He booms this out in a way they can hear it. And he tells them that, and we'll speak more about the 10 commandments next week in a bit more detail, Lord willing. But notice the reaction of the people to this overwhelming majesty of God, his presence as depicted in this theophany, in this thunder, this lightning, this smoke, the trumpet sounds. Their reaction is they're terrified. They're terrified. That's why I always say, you know, this idea that our culture's got a God, you just bop into God. What up? Do you see anybody who even thinks about coming near God like that? Nobody. Because God is holy and righteous. And so when God speaks, they're thinking, you know, this manifestation, he's too close, we're going to be killed. And so there's something here going, they're just terrified. And Moses reassures them by saying that God's nearness in this theophany, it was a test to see if they really would be afraid of disobeying him. That's what this is. This is a test to see if you really fear the Lord. And you see, fearing the Lord in the sense that we fear the consequences of defying or rebelling against him, that is spiritually healthy, and it is commanded throughout the Bible. Many places in the New Testament. I could just give you like 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 17 is directly commanded. Fear the Lord. There are many places in the New Testament. Walking in fear of the Lord. And when Paul says to somebody they have no fear of God, that's not a compliment. You see, this is spiritually healthy, that we fear the consequences. That's the first bell. Whew. All right, that we fear the consequences, you see, of defying or rebelling against God. It helps to keep us from abandoning him. And you would know that with a parent, you see. You understood that if you had a parent who was, you know, a parent was there, and loved you and cared for you, and as long as you didn't rebel against the parent, there's nothing to worry about, right? But if you decided to stick your tongue out at your parent, or say something like, I'm going to go run off and do something and I don't care a thing about you, drop dead. Well, then, you see, fear of the rebelling would be a healthy thing because it would help you not to do that. Okay? So fear of the Lord is something, it's not an Old Testament thing. Oh, this is old. We grew out of it. Fear of the Lord is something that is healthy. But, as you may be thinking, you see, there's something else that goes on here. There is a sense, you see, fearing the consequences of rebelling or abandoning God is something that's spiritually healthy. But fearing the Lord in the sense that we fear He may damn us, despite our faith in His Son, that He may damn us because we're merely weak rather than defiant or rebellious, that is not spiritually healthy. You see, that is not spiritually healthy. That's the kind of fear that we are not to have in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18. You know, there is no fear in love. We're not to have that. But you see, that gets to this whole idea of the notion that you and I can fail in weakness and we can stumble within an overall submission, and that's different than rebelling or defying. Right? As I've tried to get people to understand this, within a marriage, you understand your commitment to your spouse, to honor her, to treat her like Christ, love her like Christ loves the church, sacrifice for her and all that. If I ask a husband, have you perfectly lived out that commitment in your life? Or have you ever within that larger commitment failed what you would have liked to have done in that regard? Unless he's lying, he's going to say yes. Okay, I have failed. Okay, well, does that mean that I ever abandoned that? No. It means that I didn't live out what in my heart that was I was surrendered to, but I'm weak. There's a difference, I hope you can see, between that and somebody who says, pfft, right? And I've used the picture of the child walking down, falls, father's here, come on, fall, fall, come on, fall, fall. Kid gets there, you think father goes, pfft, what's wrong with you? No. But that's different than a kid who makes an obscene gesture toward his father, right? Okay? That's the idea. And so I think there's a whole healthy fear of the consequences of rebelling and abandoning, but there is an improper fear that somebody can creep into and live in paranoia that I can have no peace in Christ. You trust the Lord Jesus Christ and you be at peace. Okay? That's an important thing, I think. Exodus 20, 21. Moses goes back up the mountain where he met with God and he receives many additional laws, instructions, and promises. And in Exodus 24, he tells all the people all the words of the Lord and all the rules. And the people say, look, all the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do. And then Moses writes down all the words of the Lord that he received during that encounter. He reads them to all the people. After he's already said them, he writes them down, he reads them. And the people again say after that, they say, listen, they say, all the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do. Moses writes them down. The people then again say they would obey everything. In verse 7 of Exodus 20. And so he winds up then, Moses, He builds an altar. He has sacrifices offered. He throws half the blood of the sacrifices against the altar. He has the people then say again that they will obey. And then he throws the remaining blood on the people and he says, behold the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all your words. So here is this covenant through this ritual that was very meaningful. That now you are a covenant partner with God. You're in. You've all said it. You are His people, and He is your God. Okay, now you see, this is a subset of the larger Abrahamic covenant. You see, this is a temporary subset. You see, this is not to be permanent, as we know. But it's a covenant that is made with the people. And then Moses and Aaron's two sons, Nadab and Abihu. If I miss the second bell, somebody signal me. Then 70 of the elders of Israel, which would include Joshua. These people represent the leaders, they are the leaders and they represent Israel, and they go up partway up the mountain and they share in this covenant meal. You see, this is part, I heard that. This is part of this covenant, you see. So he has Israel represented by these leaders and they share in this covenant meal, and they are at that time given a glimpse of some shape or something of God where it seems as though his feet are walking on sapphire. You see, so they were given this great vision, and then they come down, and then Moses is going to go back up, and this is as fast as I can talk, so I'm going to have to do something else. Okay, but I heard that bell. Thank you.